Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good morning. Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It is great to be in God's house with you this morning. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen. Amen. It is great to be worshiping with you this morning. If we haven't had the pleasure of meeting, I am Zach Fitzpatrick, and I have the privilege of serving as the pastor of this wonderful, wonderful church. If this is your first time with us, whether you are local, whether you are from out of town, welcome. We are so glad that you are here. There is no better way to spend today than celebrating the greatest news that the world has ever known, and that is the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now, I'm going to keep this very simple as far as announcements go and simply say that I hope that you will be back with us next Sunday here at Elizabeth Lee, and the Sunday after that, and the Sunday after that. This is a wonderful place full of so many ministries. And it's a great place to call home. And it is so great to be gathered as the body of Christ together. I want to invite you into a time of preparation to encounter the presence of the living God today as our chancel choir offers our prelude and as our acolytes light the candles. Let's prepare our hearts and minds for this time of worship. Thank you. Amen. Thank you so much, choir. I invite you into a time of prayer. Absolutely. Very well warranted. Let's pray together. Jesus, what a glorious day it is as we get to celebrate your resurrection, your triumph over the grave. Jesus, just as you rose, we rise. Just as you conquered death in you, by your power, we conquer death. Jesus, we pray that today would be a celebration of you and your power and your love and your glorious presence on display. Jesus, we pray that today we would celebrate because the tomb is empty. Jesus, we pray this prayer in your name. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Please stand and join us for our opening hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today.
Oh,
And normally we sing one or two or three verses of each hymn, but trying to pick out which verses of Christ the Lord is risen today we should sing was just a task that I was not willing to complete. And so we ended up singing them all, and you got to sing all of them on Easter Sunday. Christ the Lord is risen today. Friends, I want to invite you to join me now in the Apostles' Creed that is printed in your order of service. Let's affirm our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's take a moment and greet each other with the love of Jesus Christ this morning. Amen. Please be seated. Let me go to God in prayer together this morning. We've got a few prayer requests that I want to share with you, and then if you have any that we can lift up, we can certainly do that. But I would ask you to be in prayer. Bob Wilson mentioned this morning that his aunt, Florence, passed away, and so he asked us to be in prayer for his family and for all of Florence's family. Also, Diana Irwin had her foot surgery on Friday. She is home, and as you can imagine, she is in a lot of pain, and so she asked for us to be in prayer for her. And then also Jared asked me earlier for us to be in prayer for his mom. This is her first Easter without her husband, Jared's dad, who passed away back in December. And so her name is Kim, and so would ask you to be in prayer for her as well. Any other prayer requests that we can lift up? Yeah, okay, Heather?
A couple of weeks ago, I asked for prayer for my friend here. Connie had a massive stroke. Mm-hmm. Connie passed away early this morning.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. So this is Connie, who we prayed for a couple of weeks ago, who had a massive stroke, passed away this morning. Absolutely. Yeah, Julie?
I like to pray for Martha Tumblin.
Yeah. Absolutely. So Martha Tumblin in intensive care and not expected to make it.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, Dana.
My niece, Emmy Gross, fell down and broke her tailbone.
Yes, she did. Yes, absolutely. We will
Please pray for her.
Absolutely. We will be praying for Emmy, and that was a elementary school track team accident, wasn't it? Yes, I heard all about that on Wednesday afternoon at home. So I am so, so sorry to hear about that. So you get to sit on a donut for a while, don't you? Gotcha. Gotcha. No fun. No fun. Very painful. Who else? Yep. Yes.
My sister-in-law Sally is undergoing therapy for leukemia.
Oh no! Yeah, absolutely.
But she had a bone marrow transplant and it was 100% match. So
oh wow!
She will be hard.
Absolutely. So that is very good news. So this is Kristen's sister-in-law Sally that we're praying for. Absolutely. And so that bone marrow match is an answer prayer. So very good news. Very good news. Who else? Yeah, Courtney. Oh no. Oh no. So Darlene, right?
Yes.
All right. I was trying to come up with a name and I was like, I think that sounds right. All right, good. Thank you. Thank you, Darlene. Yep. Anybody else? All right, let's go to God in prayer together, friends. Most gracious and almighty God, we give you thanks for the good news that we get to celebrate today. Jesus, your resurrection is our resurrection. Your new life is our new life. Your eternity is our eternity. Not because we've earned it, not because we deserve it, but because, Jesus, you offer it to us as a gift that we can never repay, that we'll never earn, that we certainly don't deserve. Jesus, thank you. We thank you for what happened Friday. We thank you, Lord, for the love that words cannot describe. Your willingness to go to the cross. We thank you for the forgiveness that it brings. And Jesus, we pray that just as we have been forgiven of our sins when we confess those to you, and the work that happened Friday, and Jesus, and the thanksgiving that lives in our hearts, we pray that the joy of Easter Sunday would be something that lives in our hearts today and tomorrow and always. But Jesus, we thank you for the invitation into eternity that you issued us upon leaving the grave and rising to new life. Not only is that an invitation, but Jesus, it is also a holy command to pick up our cross and follow you and do our absolute best to be the people that you have called us to be, to live and love and serve and give just like you have, Jesus. And while we will never be up to that task, Jesus, we pray that we would do our absolute best to live a life worthy of the call to discipleship, the call to follow you. And Jesus, we lift up to you in prayer each of these names, these families, people who are near and dear to our hearts. We lift up to you in prayer Diana, Kim, Darlene, Sally, Martha. That we pray, Lord, your healing blessing to be upon each of these folks, Lord. Sometimes spiritual healing, sometimes physical healing, but all of it comes from you. Jesus, we know that you know each situation. And Jesus, we trust you that in your perfect wisdom, as the great physician, you can bring the healing that is needed, both earthly healing and eternal healing. And Jesus, we also lift up to you the family of Bob Wilson's Aunt Florence, and for Connie's family, as Heather lifted up earlier. Jesus, we pray that in the midst of their grief, especially during this season at Easter, we pray that in their grief, the good news of the resurrection that would be a reminder, a peaceful and comforting reminder to them that you have conquered death. Jesus, we pray that we as your people would live lives worthy of the resurrection. And we invite that resurrection power to be at work in all of us today. Jesus, this prayer we pray in your name and as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time I will invite our ushers and our acolyte forward as we continue our worship this morning through our giving. Some of you give through the offering plate. Some of you give online through our website, elmc.church/give. However you give, we are thankful for your generosity that supports the many, many wonderful ministries here at our church.
kings from afar, the wedding, the water, the wine.
Now it was done, taken her son.
Thank you. pray together, friends. Most gracious and almighty God, we give you thanks for the bounty of your blessings in our lives. Jesus, in the form of your crucifixion and your resurrection, you gave us your best. And Jesus, we pray that today and always, we would give you our best. Lord, through our singing, through our worship, through our serving, through our studying of your word, and Jesus, through the giving of your tithes and our offerings. Jesus, accept these gifts as a portion of our best to the one who gave his best for us. Jesus, we pray this prayer in your name. Amen. Please be seated. And Paige is going to come forward for this morning's scripture reading. Yeah. Your name's in the bulletin. I'll be glad to. No problemo.
Get that email.
Here's the good news. There's not a lot of big fancy words in this one.
Okay.
All right.
That's fantastic.
Mark 16, 1 to 8. There you go. Might need your reading glasses for that one. You've got a small print.
I might. It's little. All right. When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they may go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb? And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid.
Is that it? Verse I can't eight. Remember what you Verse said. Eight.
That was it.
That's it.
May God bless the hearing and reading of his word.
Thank you. Well
thank you.
to our choir. Somebody asked me one time, Zach, what do you prefer? Do you prefer contemporary? Do you prefer traditional worship? And I said, really, I don't have a preference. If you make me choose, I really don't think I can choose. And my answer included, those pipes will talk to you, right? I love a choir and an organ and a piano come together is absolutely beautiful. So thank you so much to our choir and everybody who has made everything about today, whether it's breakfast, the sunrise service, whatever it may be, happen. Today as we start, I want to tell you a story about one of the most embarrassing times in my life. So I was in the seventh grade. When I was in the seventh grade, we had a guest speaker come to our school. To this day, I could not tell you who this guest speaker was. Apparently, the guest speaker was a fairly famous guy because all the sixth graders were excited about hearing him. I didn't know who he was then. I still don't know who he is now. I couldn't call his name if my life depended on it. And he was coming to speak to the entire sixth grade class in our gym. And they chose one seventh grader to introduce this speaker. That seventh grader was me. And so the day before, one of the teachers handed me a piece of paper. And on that piece of paper was a script. And that script was what I was supposed to read to introduce the speaker the next day. And so I got home and I practiced and I practiced and I practiced and I was ready to go. And so the time came, and so I left my classroom and I went to the gym and I took the microphone and I got in front of the entire sixth grade class. And I was going through the spiel. I was reading it off. I was listing all of the accomplishments that this speaker had had and why these sixth graders could pay attention to it. Right? And I got to the last line, and the last line of that script said, "And let's give a warm whole middle school welcome to," but there was no speaker's name. The speaker's name wasn't there. And I had practiced this 1,000 times, but I couldn't remember the speaker's name either. And so I said, "Let's give a warm whole middle school welcome to," and his name wasn't there. And I looked to my left thinking, surely there's a teacher who will come bail me out. And I looked to my right, surely there's a teacher who will come bail me out, and nobody came. And fear just overtook my body. And I was mortified. I was embarrassed. And finally, the speaker walked up. Took like an eternity. It was probably 4 or 5 seconds, right? But the speaker came up. And you see, what I had done is I had folded that piece of paper just like this. Because everything on that script would fit on a half sheet of paper, or so I thought. So I was holding that script in my hand, and the speaker came up and took that script out of my hand and very gently flipped the piece of paper over. And there in big bold letters was his name. I was mortified. I mean, I was embarrassed beyond belief. I handed that microphone to the speaker. I put my head down. I walked to the door. I walked back to my classroom, never to speak of it again. I want you to imagine that you were one of the guards at the tomb on that Sunday morning, right? You have been placed there in front of Jesus' tomb, right? The stone has been rolled in front of the tomb. You have been placed there in front of the tomb specifically to guard it. Why? To make sure that nobody would come and steal Jesus' body and then claim he's risen from the dead, just like he said. But really, Jesus' body would have been stolen and gone hidden somewhere, and then somebody would have claimed that he had risen from the dead. And so your job is simply to protect the tomb and protect Jesus' body from being stolen, because he's dead. But then the angel appears. And the angel appears and says to these women who have come to anoint his body for burial, "I realize you're not going to believe this, but he's not in there. He's alive. I know that sounds crazy, but he's alive, and here's where you're supposed to go to find him." Back to that embarrassing story. Don't feel sorry for me. Don't feel sorry for me. I realize it was a painful learning experience, but it was a learning experience nonetheless. And back to those guards, those soldiers in front of the tomb. Here they are, these big soldiers, these strong soldiers. And when the angel appears and the earthquake happens and the thunder rolls and the lightning strikes, what happens to them? They fall out. They're weak in the knee, right? They couldn't have punched their way out of a paper sack. These are the strongest soldiers in the entire world. And here they are. They can't even stand up straight. How embarrassing. Don't feel sorry for them. Don't feel sorry for them. Why? Because they got a front row seat to the greatest news that the world has ever known. Right? Something that tells me that just like, you think about when Jesus was on the cross, what did he turn to the thief and say? Today you'll be with me in paradise. Something tells me that because these soldiers got a front row seat to the greatest news that the world has ever known, something tells me that one day you and I will get the opportunity to meet them in paradise and say, tell me, what was it like standing there? Don't feel sorry for them. They got a front row seat to the greatest news that the world has ever known. Today we're going to take a look at a passage of Scripture. A passage of Scripture in which Paul tells the Christians in Corinth, hey, if Jesus truly rose from the dead, Christians, don't ever feel sorry for yourself. Don't ever feel sorry for yourself. There is nothing that Jesus can ask of you. There is nothing that Jesus can ask of you when it comes to picking up your cross and following him. Nothing that Jesus can ask of you where you should feel sorry for yourself or where you should feel sorry for any other Christian. No reason to feel sorry for ourselves. Because today's news is the greatest news that the world has ever known. Now, before we go any further, let's take a look at our scripture lesson for today. It's Paul telling the Christians in Corinth, hey, if the resurrection's true, don't feel sorry for yourself. Anything Jesus asks you to do pales in comparison to the good news of today. So it comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and it's verses 12 through 19. And I invite you to stand now in honor of the reading of God's word. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is in vain. We are even found to be misrepresenting God because we testified about God that he raised Christ, whom he did not raise. But if it is true, whom he did not raise, if it is true that the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. Friends, this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please be seated. Just imagine for a second that Jesus didn't rise from the dead. I'm not saying he did. Obviously, I believe that he did. But imagine for a second if Jesus didn't rise from the dead. I have to tell you, I feel so sorry for those women at the tomb. I feel so sorry for those guards who were standing here. You see, the angel appeared, right, to these women. The earth shook, thunder roared, lightning struck. And this angel told these women, I know you're not going to believe it, but he's not here. And at first, they probably thought, his body's been stolen. Oh, no. What happened? They thought the worst. But very quickly, the angel said, no. He's alive. He's not here because this tomb is empty and he's alive. the greatest news that the world has ever known. But let's suppose for a second that that didn't happen. Let's suppose for a second that what the angel said was a lie. If what the angel said is a lie, I feel terribly sorry for those women. I feel terribly sorry for those tomb guards and what they had to go through. Why? Because they were manipulated. Why? Right? Because their hearts were played like. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, I feel sorry for you and I feel sorry for me, because everything we have ever done for Jesus is completely in vain. But if he did rise, then anything that Jesus asks us to do, anything he asks us to do, everything he asks us to do, pales in comparison to the benefit that you and I receive today. Right? The benefit of the resurrection in our lives. Friday, our sins were forgiven, and today, you and I were issued an invitation into eternal life. Today is that important. We've got a pastor friend in Minnesota. He's a Lutheran pastor. And one time, he asked me, he said, Zach, suppose for a second that it was scientifically proven, that Jesus was dead, that he didn't rise from the grave. Suppose for a second that it wasn't just people who said, oh, Jesus is dead, we found his body. But no, it was scientifically proven, DNA evidence proved, they found a body in a tomb, that's Jesus of Nazareth, you could still see the scars in his body. If it was scientifically proven that Jesus didn't rise from the dead, are you still a Christian? That was his question to me. Yeah, and so I'll pose that question to you. If that was true, if it was proven that Jesus didn't rise from the dead, would you still be a Christian? I'll give you 3 seconds to think about it. 3, 2, 1. My answer? Not in a million years. I am out. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, I am done. Why? Because I'm not willing to follow someone who claims to be someone that they are not, right? Because that is nothing more than a lie. I am not willing to follow someone who is a liar. I am not willing to follow someone who manipulates my emotions and my heart and plays it like a fiddle. If Jesus didn't rise from the dead, I am done. But if he did, and obviously I believe he did, right? If he did, then anything that he asked me to do, anything that he asked you to do, right? Living, loving, serving, giving, just like Jesus, anything that involves picking up our cross and following Jesus, anything he asks of us is totally worth it. No questions asked. Shouldn't feel sorry for ourselves, because the benefit that you and I receive today through his resurrection pales in comparison to the cost of anything that he asks us to do in this life. Today is that important. I want to tell you a quick story to illustrate the importance of what happened today. I want to tell you the story of Anthony Clark. You may never have heard the name of Anthony Clark. Anthony Clark was a British artillery officer. He was a British artillery officer during World War II, and that's him right there on the screen, right? That's Anthony Clark. And he was ordered, he and his troops were in the Italian town of Sansepolcro, and he was ordered to open fire on the town of Sansepolcro, Italy. You see, British troops, right, had pretty good intelligence that Germans were in that town. And so they were ordered to open fire. But Anthony Clark refused. He's an artillery officer, and he refused to open fire on the town of Sansepolcro, Italy. Why? Well, you see, Anthony Clark was both a devout Christian, and he loved art. And he knew, he had read in a book, right, through his study of art, he knew that somewhere in the town of Sansepolcro, Italy, he didn't know where, but he knew that there hung a painting, that painting right there, that had been described as the most important painting, the most important picture in all of the world. That painting right there is called The Resurrection. It's by a painter by the name of Piera della Francesca. That painting hung somewhere in Sansepolcro, Italy, and he was not willing on his watch to see that, to see the resurrection go up in smoke. Any other painting in Italy? Fair game. But that painting, not on his watch. Because he knew that everything that that painting, and we'll talk about it more in a minute, everything that it represented was that important. Now, as it turned out, Anthony Clark didn't need to open fire. You see, what the British troops didn't know is that the German troops had already started retreating from that town. So if they had opened fire, it would have been in vain, that there would have been nobody there. But they didn't know that at the time, that he refused to open fire. Well, Anthony Clark ended up being a hero in this town, and there is now a street in the town of Sansepolcro, Italy, named after the British artillery officer, Anthony Clark. He knew that today was that important. If you've been with us for a while at Elizabeth Lee, you know that occasionally I like to kind of take a look at some of the Christian art throughout history and look at some of the meaning behind it. And it's not because I've always been some big fan of art. I told the earlier service that I took art appreciation in college, not because I appreciated art, but because I thought that music or that art appreciation would be less awful than all of the other appreciation classes that I could take, right? That was where my mind was at the time. Now, with age and hopefully a little bit of wisdom along the way, I've come to realize that there is beautiful meaning in art and music and all of those other things. But at the time I wasn't there. But I want you to pull this painting. It's in your bulletin. It's going to be up on the screen as well. I want you to take a look at this painting with me for just a minute. There's so much that we could talk about, but we've only got time for just a few things that I want to point out to you. The first thing that I want you to notice the abs that Jesus has. I know that's the first thing I noticed too, but Jesus' body is perfectly chiseled. Why? Perfectly God. Perfectly divine. At the same time, you see the wounds, and you see a few wrinkles right above his belly button. Yeah, he's perfectly God, but he's also perfectly human. All at the same time. The next thing I want you to notice is Jesus has his left leg placed up on something. What is that something? That is a tomb. That tomb in the painting is an exact replica, at least in painting form, of the tomb that sits in the Church of the Holy Sepulchre in Jerusalem. If you go into the Church of the Holy Sepulchre today, you will see a tomb that looks exactly like that. What's the Church of the Holy Sepulchre? Well, it's a church that's been built in Jerusalem on top of the exact site where it's believed that Jesus was crucified. And it's possible that that tomb was the one, who knows, but it's possible it's the one that Jesus was placed in. And Jesus is standing essentially on top of his tomb. Now, notice the four soldiers here who are down front. They are passed out. They've been scared to death by everything that happened. The one in the brown, the second one from the left, that is a self-portrait of Piero della Francesca, the painter. But the last thing I want you to notice, and this is the most important thing, at least for our conversation for today. Notice the trees. Got trees on the left, got trees on the right. The trees on the right, they're green. They're bearing leaves. The trees on the left, dead, no leaves, brown, lifeless, everything that goes along with it. Well, these trees are meant to represent the final judgment. Right, the final judgment and the resurrection kind of go hand in hand together, because the resurrection, it means that all of us are offered the promise of eternal life for all who believe. So the resurrection makes the final judgment really important. And what do we know about the final judgment? What does Jesus say? He says we're going to be separated into two groups. The sheep on the right, the goats on the left. Right. Well, what's the difference between the sheep and the goats? Think about this with the trees. The sheep are the ones who bear fruit. Which trees are bearing fruit? Which trees are green? Which trees are leafy? The ones on the right. The sheep are the ones that bear fruit. They're the ones that inherit eternal life. The goats are the ones who don't bear fruit, and they inherit eternal punishment. Now, how do you and I bear fruit? You and I bear fruit according to what Jesus said. When we feed the hungry, when we clothe the naked, when we visit the sick, all of those sorts of things. In other words, when we pick up our cross and follow Jesus, when we live and love and serve and give in the way that Jesus expects of us. Now, sometimes we might think that that is an awful lot that Jesus asked of us. But it pales in comparison, right, to the reward that you and I receive today. Today is that important. Today is so important that anything that Jesus asked of us, in order to become sheep, anything that Jesus asked of you and me, it pales in comparison. The cost pales in comparison to the benefit that you and I receive from the resurrection. Today is that important. Right? Through the resurrection, you and I receive the promise that for all who believe, upon our deaths, we will experience a spiritual resurrection where we ascend up into heaven with God. And then when Jesus comes back in final victory, our spirit has already ascended. Then when Jesus comes back in final victory, guess what we receive? We receive a bodily resurrection. We receive a new resurrection, right? Where we will spend all of eternity, the souls we know today, along with a new body, in heaven with Jesus forever. Friends, that is what makes today so important. Anything that Jesus asked of you and me, then he asked a lot. But anything Jesus asked pales in comparison to the benefit that you and I receive today. Because today, Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, is that important. Let's pray together. Jesus, we give you thanks for the gift of the resurrection in our lives. Lord, for the promise that whoever serves you and follows you and calls upon your name, there is life, abundant life, and everlasting life. Jesus, we pray that sometimes when we wrestle with the expectations that you have for us of living and loving and serving and giving just like you did, sometimes we can feel sorry for ourselves. Sometimes we can say, woe is me. Sometimes we can say, Jesus, this is too much. Jesus, we pray that we would resist that temptation. Jesus, help us to resist that temptation, knowing that, yes, you ask a lot, but the reward that we receive today through your resurrection, Jesus, it pales in comparison. Today was that important. And we pray, Jesus, that today and tomorrow and the next tomorrow and the next Easter, and the next Easter after that, we would remember how important today is. We pray this prayer, Jesus, in your name. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing our closing hymn today. It's on the back of your bulletin. It is, I Know That My Redeemer Lives. Let's stand and sing together. this place to receive this benediction now, anything that Jesus asks of us, it is never, never too much. Because today is that important. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and God's people say together,
Amen. Amen.